Who wasn't here in 1990? Right. You can blame your parents for this then, and your teachers and your lecturers. You know, for 30 years, throughout all of your life, we have known the scale of the challenge. We have known what we need to do. We knew all the science we needed and the technologies and everything else. Everything was there for us to act, and we actively chose not to. Climate change is now system change. We've left it so late that we have to change the system. That isn't, you know, that's not a choice that I'm here making for any political reasons. It's simply what the maths tells us. And the other thing is, of course, we need to completely, fundamentally shift, like the Marshall Plan, Marshall-style plan after the Second World War, when you reconstructed Europe after we'd blown it all up. We've got it's that level of change we're talking about. So you need to sort of pin people down to say, well, what is the problem you're trying to address, and how does your work fit that within the right time frame? And that doesn't happen very often at all.
And literally pin them down.
Yeah. Yeah, there might be a wise with some of them, yes. So at least stop them emitting and flying around the world. So I should say, in addition, I did used to design and build offshore oil platforms, so you can throw your fruit at me now. So I spent quite a lot of time in the North Sea back in the 1980s and early 90s. So I call this talk here Hope from Despair. I should say a little bit of hope from despair, really. And I have, for those of you engaged on social media stuff, I have a Twitter account, which is reasonably active. But I only use it for work, so I don't engage in anything else other than work things on Twitter or any other form of social media for that. And I've called this here Transforming Delusion into Action on Climate Change. And I'm trying to go through a bit of a whistle-stop tour, mostly around issues about what we do about reducing our emissions and with a focus on energy. So some of you here no doubt are probably experts or got quite interested in the food issues and agriculture. That's not my area of expertise. I have colleagues that work in those areas. They are very important. About 20% of our warming there or thereabouts is caused by emissions from the agricultural sector, primarily methane and N2O emissions from fertilizer. They are important. They need to be reduced. They can be reduced, but they can't be eliminated. So even if we all went vegan and didn't eat any rice, then we'd still have emissions from the agricultural system at quite a high level. Nevertheless, we need to reduce them significantly. But with energy, we can eliminate the emissions from energy, the carbon dioxide emissions, and I'm going to be focusing on those today. That's not to belittle the importance of agriculture, but that's the area I work on. I'm going to start off, can you all see the slides quite clearly? Yep, good. Given you an Extinction Rebellion, you probably have a fairly good idea of some of this stuff anyway. So I'm going to start off with the Paris Climate Change Agreement, and that it commits us to take action, and that's important. It commits us to take action, not just to talk about it, actually in the agreement, to hold the increase temperatures well below 2 degrees centigrade, and ideally keep it near a 1.5. And the 1.5, for those of us that were in Paris, was quite a shock that that was included. And I was not pleased it was included at the time. And I've reflected on it since, and I'm pleased it is there. I have to say, I don't think it's achievable, but I might be wrong. I hope to be wrong on this. I increasingly think it's unlikely. I think we will be really pushed to hold the 2 degrees centigrade. But let's also be clear that these are not safe thresholds. 1.5 is not safe. Lots of people will die, and we've known who they will be for a long time. They're going to be poor, low emitting, living in certain parts of the world, and typically non-white. And we've known that for 30 years, and we haven't cared about them, and we still don't care about them now, not at a collective level. So these are not safe thresholds at all. And 2 degrees centigrade of warming is about 6 degrees in the poles, so it's a huge shift in the weather patterns and the climatic structures of our planet. We also agreed to do this in line with the best science, which is broadly captured by the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change Working Group 1. But it's also worth bearing in mind that science is rightly and innately a conservative process. So, you know, as the science evolves, then it takes time for it to almost like for the orthodoxy to catch up, if you like. And that's right. But that does mean you have to look at the science with a discerning eye. And that's important when you look at what's in the IPCC, because it is typically fairly conservative. That's not a criticism at all. That's how it should be. We also agreed to reduce our emissions on the basis of equity, and no part of the world takes that into account seriously. And the UK is a good example, and nor does Sweden. So equity is, I think, it's an absolutely key issue, and I'll come back to that later, but it's pretty much ignored between countries and even within countries. Now, I'm going to focus on mitigation, on reducing emissions, because that's the bit I work on, but I'm going to just touch on impacts, and you probably know much more about this than me. But just to think that, as I said before, the Paris challenge is unjust. So we're not starting off with a just position, we're starting off with an unjust position. And all we can do is not make it as bad as it could otherwise be. We can't do anything fairly anymore. Fairness went out the window a long time ago. We can just do things that are less unfair. That's the best that we can work at now. You know, people in like this are suffering around the world already today. You know, the typhoon exacerbated in Mozambique, people in Katrina, the people in Sandy, in the Philippines and so forth. There are lots of people around the world already suffering weather events that are exacerbated by climate change. Probably not caused by, probably with the Darfur pasture lands a few years ago, but so these people are suffering now. We already know that quite a few species are being very seriously affected. We're almost certainly going to lose virtually all of the barrier reef. Yeah, and okay, it's an emblematic ecosystem, but the idea that we have managed successfully in little more than 50 to 70 years to rest in peace over the barrier reef is quite depressing. So that's pretty much gone now. And we'll, you know, at 1.5 degrees centigrade, there'll be a little bit left. At 2 degrees centigrade, virtually nothing left. Our own children are going to suffer the implications of what we've chosen to carry on doing and knowingly doing for the last 30 years. And as I said here, lots of these people are suffering and dying already today as a consequence of just 1 degree of warming so far, a little bit over one probably. And species, new next generations of virtually every species will be affected by what we're doing and what we're carrying on doing. So from an impacts point of view, it's pretty dire. But it's going to be much worse if we don't get our emissions under some sort of control. But let's not pretend that 1.5 to 2 degrees centigrade is a safe threshold. All of these communities will suffer very severely. So now I'm going to focus on mitigation and what that means, you know, what we're going to do to reduce our emissions with a focus on energy. But I want to start by just pointing out how badly we're actually failing. Because I think before you start to really understand what it is we have to do, we have to realise how badly down the line we are. So the UK, for some good reasons, is a self-avowed, or claims as a climate progressive country. And certainly I think I have some sort of pet reasons as to why I think the UK is actually very well informed on climate change, way ahead of Sweden. You know, the electorate, the policymakers, the journalists, the academic community is probably 10 years ahead of Sweden. Sweden's much better on sustainability, but on climate change I've been really surprised that, you know, it's quite easy for me. I can wander over there with ideas from 10 or 15 years ago and they think they're new. So it's a good place for British academics. I think that comes out of the fact that we are an island, we are a maritime island, we've been reliant on understanding the weather for our agriculture, for our maritime survival for hundreds of years. The Hadley Centre, the Met Office initially, then the Hadley Centre, are really well developed here, way ahead of most other parts of the world. So we have a history of being deeply interested in weather and climate because of our well-being. And I think that's panned across quite well into climate change. It doesn't mean we've started to do anything about it. We have a much better understanding than many parts of the world across the board. I say, and that does include civil society, the policymakers, and the journalists. But here we are, the sort of things I used to build offshore many moons ago. This is the new Clare Ridge Phase 2, and there's a Phase 3 planned as well now. BP owned this. First oil, November 2018. Now, it's planned emissions. If it follows up, I think it's 640 million barrels, I think, totally. It's about 250 million tons of carbon dioxide from that one oil platform. Some of us here will be dead when that's still operating. That's probably going to be, if it operates and we ignore climate change, then that's planning to operate for 30 plus years. So that's what we're putting in place in 2018. The new Glengorm gas discovery announced 2019, so just a year ago. Discovery of the biggest UK gas field in decades raises the industry's hopes. Industry that has actually people living in it, working in it. It raises their hopes, apparently. Planned emissions, 100 million tonnes of CO2. That's another 30 or 40 years. Hull, last summer, biggest ever onshore gas field discovered near Hull. Planned emissions, 3 million tonnes, 13 million tonnes. I can't see, there's a ripple in the screen. this, you know, thankfully, he's no longer in this position now. He's one of our worst transport ministers. But Heathrow expansion. You know, remember, that was voted for by most MPs in the House of Commons, across parties. People voted for that. If you follow the Committee on Climate Change's pathway for aviation, so it's, you know, it's not even the Department of Transport, it's the Committee on Climate Change's pathway they think is viable with tightening aviation. That's 40% of the UK's fair Paris-compliant carbon budget for that one single sector, 40%. So when people say aviation is not that important, it's about 10% in the UK for international aviation, but it represents about 40% of our total budget if you follow the Committee on Climate Change's pathway. And that's a sector that primarily serves a privileged few people who fly very regularly and occasionally serves other people who fly on holiday to Benidorm, but they're always the ones that are blamed. It's the frequent flyers that drive that sector. So across the board, we're failing, but the UK keeps claiming it's showing leadership. So this is the net zero report from the Committee on Climate Change. Is any of you not, are you all familiar with that? Is anyone not familiar with it? All right, okay. Has anyone not heard of the Committee on Climate Change? Be honest, has anyone not? Okay, some people haven't. All right, the Committee on Climate Change is a quango, if you remember quangos. It's a sort of semi-autonomous something, something, something that links to the government. It's like a civil service at arm's length, I think, probably the fairest way to describe it, funded by government. And the Committee on Climate Change was set up after the 2008 Climate Change Act to provide guidance to government on what it needs to do on climate change. And the government has to legally respond to the advice from the Committee on Climate Change. It doesn't have to take the advice, but it does have to respond legally to the advice. So it's a really important committee, and it has a really good secretariat, really good people working there. I think it has now an excellent chief executive in Chris Stark, and I think it does really bad work, because I think it is so locked into a current political paradigm. And I can say that, I won't say who it was, but I have been told by a senior person within it, they said they have to remain politically relevant. And to remain politically relevant, they've got to say things that fit within the current political paradigm. So that colours everything they say. It has a suite of commissioners. These are really good academics. Some of them are my colleagues. One or two of them have been my friends. And I think, by and large, every time the commissioners come in there as an academic, they are immediately co-opted. And then they suddenly wear a government-style hat and spin lovely stories about what we're doing on climate change. So whilst I think the Committee on Climate Change is really important, I actually think it is sold out to the current political paradigm, which is not something that you can reconcile with delivering on our Paris commitments, whether we like the paradigm or not. And I'm going to try and talk about that more. But the Committee on Climate Change has made the point, and so I've repeatedly, you hear this from academics as well, co-opted academics who don't bother to check the spreadsheets, or just want to say something that fits with government, that we have reduced our emissions by, 44% this year in the UK, which sounds quite reasonable. And I hear the same things in France, the same things in Sweden, the same things in Denmark. And all of those countries ignore aviation and shipping emissions. So every country ignores those, the international ones. So if we fly to New York, those emissions are the responsibility of God, not of any particular country. And it also ignores our imports and exports conveniently. So we're happy to blame the Chinese, the fact that this was made in China, my phone was made in China, and my laptop was made in China. We blame the Chinese for that, but we'll use the equipment. So if you take account of our imports and our exports and our aviation and shipping emissions in total, we've had about a 10% reduction in emissions since 1990. Suddenly it doesn't sound quite so good. And a large part of that 10%, if you look at it, was actually because of the banking crisis. So it was a cost of austerity. And it was also driven because we've shut down a lot of coal-fired power stations. And we closed those primarily because they had high sulfur emissions. So they were breaching the large plant combustion directive of the EU, which means you can only have them operating after a certain time if they've got very low sulfur emissions, and our plants had high sulfur emissions. So we've closed those down, but not for climate change reasons. Now, there are some climate change policies that are starting to have some early impact, but the main reason we've seen this is not because of climate change. And we've now virtually closed all of our coal-fired power stations. So the easy win has been won. So things aren't looking particularly positive. That's 0.4% every single year. So it's not a particularly good story. If there's anything not clear as I'm going through, just call out, because if anything's not clear to you, then you can guarantee there'll be other people around here it's not clear to either. So I'm happy to try and clarify points as we go through. So what does the IPCC? That's the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. That's the UN body that collects the science every few years together and has these major set of reports. What does that tell us about the Paris Agreement? I'm going to synthesize the whole of the climate change reports, working group one. The IPCC is all full of acronyms. It's like alphabetic soup, climate change. I think it's to confuse people. So the IPCC, working group one, they deal with the science of climate change. So it's like, you know, physics and the basic science. And working group three deal with the reducing emissions, mitigation. I don't think we should have the working group three. I think it's a mistake, but anyway. But I'm going to synthesize the main science of that in one line. And it broadly says it's carbon budgets that matter. So that's the total amount of carbon dioxide we emit in the atmosphere. Not some long-term target for 2030 or 2050 or 2100. That doesn't matter. What matters is the total amount of carbon dioxide we put in the atmosphere. And that has big political repercussions. Once you start to think of it like that, that's really, you know, that changes what you have to do today. And to the UK's significant credit, the Climate Change Act in 2008, which I still think is the best piece of national legislation on climate change anywhere in the world, way better than Sweden's new 2018 climate law. Our act is way better than that. It embeds carbon budgets in it, and the Committee on Climate Change have a really good detailed approach to look at carbon budgets. They're far too big, their carbon budgets, but the framework is right. So the UK deserves credit for that. So it's not the long-term targets, it's the budgets that matter. And then, so we play those out in terms of the numbers. If we want to pursue 1.5 and stay well below 2 degrees centigrade, and in that, I know Extinction Rebellion are tend to be more focused on this, but what we've done there is to try and take the language of the Paris Agreement and then translate that to what does that mean in terms of probabilities, because that allows us to work out some numbers, basically. And well below, we take that as 66 to 100% chance of staying below 2 degrees centigrade. So a likely chance below 2 degrees centigrade is a language that's often used. And pursue 1.5, it's more of an aspiration. It's not quite such a commitment. We'd like to do that. We'll try a bit. We're not going to try quite as hard as for this. So we use this one as about a 33% or less chance of staying below 1.5. Now, I know that I think Extinction Rebellion as a group wants a higher chance of 1.5. But we're trying to take the Paris Agreement language as it is and not question whether it's right or wrong. And so we've done that, and then we're looking at this, we've sort of said that that comes out something like, for energy, this is, focus on energy, about 650 billion tonnes of carbon dioxide. There's a few numbers here, but I'll put them into context in a minute. 650 billion tonnes of carbon dioxide that we can dump in the atmosphere from the 1st of January 2020 out across the century, pretty much forever. That's what we can dump in the atmosphere the next, yeah, more decades than we can think about. And the emissions in 2018 were 37 billion tonnes and probably gone up by about 0.6% again the following year. So if you work that out, we've got 18 years of current emissions before we blow the budget at a global level for staying a good chance of staying well below 2 degrees centigrade. And I'll probably say this again later, but all of this is based on the last major report from the IPCC, SR 1.5, another set of numbers and acronyms and so forth. So it's Special Report 1.5. And in that, they have carbon budgets. Quite a few of us think those carbon budgets are too high for a set of reasons I won't go into now, but we think when the next set of reports come out, we'll have embedded more of the feedbacks that some people might think of as tipping points sort of issues. So some of these other sets of feedbacks, more of those will likely have been embedded, and it's quite possible those budgets will be smaller than ones we have now, which means that it would be even more difficult to achieve these temperatures. I mean, I think it's pretty difficult now. So if we're lucky, if the climate sensitivity, as it's called, plays in our favour, then we're lucky we can put a bit more in the atmosphere, a bit more carbon dioxide for a certain temperature. If we're unlucky, then we may well have blown the chance for 2 degrees centigrade as well. So where do we go from here? And we've got the IPCC, we've got the Paris Agreement, well below 2, pursue 1.5. We've got the IPCC work saying roughly how much we can put in the atmosphere. And so now it's, well, what do we do about this? Now we've got the information. You know, we should have some idea about how rapid the action needs to be. Well, the first point is to remember where we are and have some humility on this. The first report came out in 1990 for the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. Now, when I'm talking to my students, I always point out to them that's before their parents met. So quite often their parents were still at school and we had the first report. Now, if I look around here, some of you are more my age, one or two of you are a bit older. There's a few of you who are pretty young. Who wasn't here in 1990? Right, you can blame your parents for this then, and your teachers and your lecturers. You know, for 30 years, throughout all of your life, we have known the scale of the challenge. We have known what we need to do. We knew all the science we needed and the technologies and everything else. Everything was there for us to act. And we actively chose not to. And the we is quite important on that. It's not everyone's that case, but a lot of us collectively, we have failed right throughout your lives. In 2018, the emissions were about 67% higher than they were in 1990 of carbon dioxide. And they're rising still in 2018. And almost certainly they'll have risen, went up 1.6% in 2018. And they'll almost certainly have gone up again this year in provisional estimates, 2019. They probably would have gone up by about, say, 0.5%, 0.6 of a percent. So what we've had is, I haven't changed that number, so say 30 years. We've had 3 decades, 30 years of abject failure. In other words, right through your lives, some of you, we have failed on climate change. And you can see why there's a sort of generational sort of skepticism about my generation, because we had this information that was there. That's not to say we should have the generations fighting each other, but I think it's important to recognise that. And thus far, we have had a whole sort of suite of what I call technocratic fraud, or svindlery, as they call it in Sweden. We've had partial accounting, so we ignore things like aviation and shipping. Offsetting, which is, like if you're trying to lose weight and you ask a poor person to, or someone else to diet for you, cut back on the chocolate. Sadly, it doesn't work. Offsetting is very similar. And in fact, I would say offsetting is worse from the emissions point of view, and I wrote about this in Nature in 2012. From an emissions point of view, I think offsetting is worse than doing nothing. That's not to say some of the projects aren't really worthwhile. But from an overall emissions perspective, I think that offsetting makes the situation worse, partly because it locks in the high carbon behaviour of the person paying for the offset. And almost always, the person who's receiving the money from the offset will help them develop faster if it's a poor part of the world. And that's good. That's not a bad thing. I want poor parts of the world to develop faster. And even if they develop faster using renewable energy, that'll still give them access to other things that means that they will probably get more fossil fuels embedded in their lives, more consumption. So in the immediate to near term, they'll probably see a rise in their emissions. So overall emissions go up. So offsetting, the schemes we should perhaps fund if they're good schemes, but we should not fund them as an offset. They do not offset. And then we have governments doing the same thing. It's called the Clean Development Mechanism. So just give it a fancy title and you can hide any scam. So the Clean Development Mechanism, which governments all around the world use to, rich governments around the world use to offset their emissions by paying a poor country to do it. And we're now planning on afforestation. This is what Sweden's planning to do, to expand its main airport, Arlanda Airport in Stockholm. It's saying, well, we'll be carbon neutral, this expansion, because we're going to plant more trees in the north of Sweden. Forestry immediately sounds like a wonderful idea, and in many respects, of course, it is. I think we should plant trees for, I always argue, for tree reasons, or sort of good reasons for planting trees, but not for necessarily absorbing carbon. Firstly, afforestation is problematic because if you plant forests in areas where the soils haven't had forests for a long time, it could be that you get more emissions from the soil than you get absorption of carbon in the trees. You can get forest restoration, which is when you take areas that were previously, quite recently forested, have been deforested, and the soils are probably still appropriate. You can go back and plant some trees there. That's probably quite good. And you get forestry management, where you improve the quality of often very badly managed forests, and you can increase the amount of carbon uptake. That's also very good. All these things, or at least two of those things, can be good from a sustainability perspective and might help from a carbon perspective. But there's no guarantee, because if the climate carries on changing, what happens if they get pests move, and those trees then die because you've got some new moth larva that's moved up because it's got warmer? So there's a whole suite of reasons to why you shouldn't be relying on trees to reduce our emissions. That's not to say we shouldn't be planting trees, of course we should. And then we're also increasingly, I'm going to talk about this in a bit more detail later, relying on things called negative emission technologies, and it's got all sorts of acronyms. These are called NETs, negative emission technologies. These are things that, they don't do this, they're wings and prayers that are going to suck the CO2 out of the atmosphere in the future. There's other things they're given other names, like carbon dioxide removal. There's all sorts of words we use. Every time someone figures out what they are, we change the language. And these are absolutely central now to most of the scenarios that are developed in the IPCC, in the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, about what we should do about climate change. The Committee on Climate Change rely on these. Virtually every country is relying on these to solve the problem significantly for them, because it allows us to have business as usual with a bit of a green tinge to it in the short term. So I'll come back to that later. And then most people who work on this don't think it will work at the scale it's in the models, so they're already applying and considering geoengineering. An example of that would be firing rockets into the stratosphere, the upper part of the atmosphere, to spread out sulfur particles that reflect sunlight back out into space. Start to think, how mad is it that we're thinking about seriously doing that? We don't even understand the chemistry and the dynamics of the stratosphere that well, and we're thinking about doing that. And then those particles then migrate out to the poles. You have to send another rocket up into the stratosphere. and you've got to try and control this. So, we should think about these things, we should research some of these things, particularly the negative emission ones, but we should not be relying on them. We should be acting as if they don't work, because they probably won't work at scale, and they probably have lots of other sustainability implications. What we haven't tried to do in 30 years is to cut our carbon dioxide emissions. So for 30 years, we've tried all these sorts of things, but we haven't tried to cut our CO2. So we've had failure writ large at every single level so far. In a collective sense, we've failed. That's not to say some people haven't tried really hard, and there are some, if you look really carefully, you'll see some small sort of pockets of success, perhaps. But overall, we have collectively failed, and we have to recognise that. And that's why I turned to Leonard Cohen. As I was talking to someone before, but if you turn to Leonard Cohen for hope, you know how bad things are getting. I absolutely love Leonard Cohen's music. So Leonard is going to take us through a sort of a using one of his lyrics from Anthem, actually. This lyric here, which is quite a well-known lyric anyway. It takes us, I think, from despair to hope. So ring the bells that still can ring, forget your perfect offering. There's a crack in everything, and that's how the light gets in. So it's one some of you may have heard quite a few times before. So ring the bells that still can ring. We know what we need to do. We're not waiting for technology. We're not waiting for wonderful policy ideas. We know what we need to do. We need to make sure that all our houses are built to zero to passive house standards as a minimum. Now, we were planning to do that in 2016, but the government decided not to go ahead because they were lobbied by the 1850 construction industry. So we should have been doing that now, but we're not. We're still building low-quality houses in this country. We know we should have a maximum efficiency on cars, maximum emissions per kilometre for cars, so you can't buy Clarkson-type cars, and that should be tightened every single year. We know we should be eating less meat and less dairy, and particularly certain types of meat. We know that we shouldn't be having airport expansion. We know we should be retrofitting the existing buildings in the UK, which are really, in terrible condition. So we know all of these things. We're not short of things to do. There are plenty of bells to ring to get on with doing things. We're not waiting for technology. So the things we get on with, forget a perfect offering. So particularly if economists come bearing gifts, or astrologists, as I prefer to call them. So the Stern Report, have anyone here heard of the Stern Report? It's quite a famous and a really important report in some respects, because Nicholas Stern was a conventional economist, is a conventional economist, and he took on his own sort of discipline by arguing about something called discounting, so discount rates, about how you discount the costs in the future, so then things in the future are always cheaper than doing it now. But actually, he questioned that, and that was quite a brave thing to do, and he's been criticised for it repeatedly ever since. The rest of the report is not particularly good, and I always point out with economists that it's okay if they use page numbers, but they shouldn't be using any other numbers. And that's the same for this report. And as I say, economists, particular type of economists dealing with these sorts of issues. It's not all ecological economists, that's fine. But modern neoclassical economists are not used to dealing with large-scale changes, and that's what we're talking about here. So this report is awash with real mistakes on the empirical data that we collected on emissions, and it's wrong by some very significant margin, which means its conclusions are completely unhelpful. The Working Group 3 reports from the IPCC, this is the ones on mitigation, that reducing emissions, these are all dominated by a particular set of models that I'll talk about later, which are dominated by economists. Some engineers, a very sort of simple climate model, or relatively simple climate model, but principally they're models that are based on an economic growth model at their core, and then it says, what should we do about climate change? And you can't question the core of the model, which is an economic growth model. So these things, I think, are incredibly unhelpful. And then we've got Stern's newest stuff, the new climate economy. And all of this is about green growth. It's about how can you incrementally tweak the current system to make it deliver on our Paris commitments or on some sort of vague, nebulous climate change commitments. They're never quite specific about what they are. It's lots of well-meaning arm waving. Climate change is awash with people doing that. Often scientists and technologists waving their arms in the air about, oh, we're going to do something on climate change. Yeah, doing what on climate change? What does that mean, doing something on climate change? Stopping us going to 5 degrees is doing something on climate change. So you need to sort of pin people down to say, well, what is the problem you're trying to address? And how does your work fit that within the right time frame? And that doesn't happen very often at all.
Literally pin them down.
Yeah, there might be a wise with some of them, yes. Certainly stop them emitting and flying around the world. And then we've got the net zero report, as I refer to it. It should be called the not zero report. The net zero report, if you bother to look at the spreadsheets, have about 40 million tonnes of carbon dioxide emitted from fossil fuel combustion still in 2050, and they call it net zero. So it's not zero, really. And in other words, I say net often referred to net as being Latin for pass the buck on to the next generation. Because that's what this, and that language wasn't there. If you go back 5 years, you hardly ever see the word net zero. Now it's used all the time. People, oh, net zero. What the hell does it mean? You ask people, what does net zero mean? They don't know what it means. They just use it. So it's become this new language. It allows you to say anything. Net zero tomorrow if you want to. So we've got to be really careful about that. And as I said before, I have a lot of time for the Secretariat, but the framing that they've been given and they've accepted, I think, is hugely problematic. It's deeply colonial. And I know that Chris Stark doesn't like me using that term, and I didn't use it for a while, but I'm going back to using it because I think it's accurate. It takes a much larger slice of the global carbon budget than the UK should really have. Much, much larger slice. So I'll point out, we took their slaves, we took their minerals, and now we're stealing their carbon budget. So it's just part of the same old thing that rich white people in the Northern Hemisphere should get more of the world's resources, and now it's the carbon budget. So although it's the very good people doing this, we're very well-meaning liberal types, we're still carrying on with this sort of colonial view of the world. But even there, it's worse, because then we buck pass. We say, well, we're not going to make the changes. We're going to make some changes, but we're going to pass the really difficult ones on to our children and their children. So it's a generational buck passing as well. And the whole thing is there to maintain, effectively to maintain a greenwash business as usual framing of climate change. And you heard, that if anyone watched the news this week, Chris Stark, I'm picking on Chris Stark, I think Chris Stark is excellent, but Chris was on there being probed and basically saying that, there's not a lot of pain in this, we can do it with technology. And then you heard Matt Hancock saying the same thing. So there's still this discussion, we can do it all with a bit of technology. These people never built anything. They've never done any technology in their lives. So I think when you play this out, it's still trying to greenwash the current system to pretend you can deliver on your Paris commitments. If you then say, are you talking about reducing emissions in line with Paris? They're reluctant to answer that because they know damn well they haven't done the analysis, including the CCC on this. So we shouldn't be using those things that, they forget the perfect offerings because they're far from anything like perfect. So how loud must the Paris bell ring? If we're going to ring this bell, how loud is it going to have to be? So a few graphs, which hopefully not everyone likes graphs, and those of us in universities, academics and scientists love them, but to other people it makes them just doze off, so you can have a bit of a sleep in the back and we'll come back to something different later. But looking at some graphs now. So these are our emissions going out into the future. This is why we need other people other than scientists communicating climate change, because we like PowerPoint presentations and graphs and numbers, and other people think, bloody boring that is. But before Paris, we were heading up to 4 to 6 degrees centigrade of warming. Now, we don't know exactly what that would have been because there's a lot of uncertainty, particularly as you get warmer and warmer because of these feedbacks. But that is a completely different planet to the one on which we live. Now, that would have occurred within 100 plus years. With the Paris Agreement, we've got all the national pledges that every country in the world made. So every country was asked, well, what will you do on climate change? Every country goes away and sort of fiddles around somewhere in some spreadsheets and comes back and says, well, this is what we'll do. You add them all up, that's 3 to 4 degrees centigrade of warming. So, still a different planet, not quite as bad as the other one. But our carbon budget, as I say, looks more like that. So it's completely different. We're not up here. We have to bring it down like this. This is, and when I say this, I should, just to re-emphasise for Extinction Rebellion, this is a reasonable chance, likely chance of 2 degrees centigrade and a pretty unlikely chance of 1.5. So, you
slightly lost me there.
Sorry.
I'm sorry to ask questions.
No, it's fine.
So, look, can I just say what I thought you just said?
Yeah.
So, here we are going up, pretend Paris didn't happen, we were whizzed up there. And now this is what they say they will do in Paris, although none of them are doing it. So that still gets us about here.
Yeah.
This is what we should be doing is down here.
Yeah.
Have I understood?
That's right, yeah. That's this is just to reiterate that. So this is where that's where we were heading. Ooh, there we go. That's where we were heading. That's where and part of that is because we had a lot of economic growth in the early 2000s. So very high economic growth, very high rise in emissions, rising over 3% every single year. And that if we carried on along that sort of path, it was given various names in the scenarios, we're heading that way. Actually, we then had the Paris Agreement where people said, well, we'll make some reductions, but they haven't done it, that's true. Well, they haven't done it, but the economic growth has come down, not least because, the one time you can thank bankers is because they collapsed the world economy. And so actually what's happened is economic growth has come down, so the main reason, or a significant part of the reason that we're on this line, not going up here, is because of the change in the world economy. I wouldn't say something else there, but it means we've been filmed or not, I won't say it. But, yeah, so the bankers, for one time in your life, you can thank them, but not give them any bonuses, I would say. But that's why we're 3 to 4. But we should, you know, we've committed to 2 degrees centigrade, which is something like this. And that's zero carbon energy by about 2050. So remember that. It is unrealistic, but I'm going to come back to that a little bit later. Depends what you... I mean, I always turn this around in its head to say, which is more unrealistic, that angle or living prosperous lives with 3 to 5 degrees centigrade? So there isn't... The point is, there's always the other side of the coin. So, you know, realism is an interesting one. We always look at it... Typically, we look at realism on one bit. Oh, that's unrealistic. Well, I think it doesn't look as unrealistic as trying to live a good life at 3 to 5 degrees. So I think we have to turn these things around. Yeah, we should have done this earlier. If we'd started in 1990, it wouldn't quite look like that. The problem, every year we fail, it gets steeper and steeper. But we've also agreed, because actually it's much steeper than that for us, actually, because we've agreed to do this on the basis of equity. So we have signed up in Paris, in good faith, assuming our leaders weren't lying, to actually reduce emissions for the wealthy countries ahead of the poor parts of the world. And that's really important, but no one takes that seriously. And we've tried to do that in a paper that we just got accepted today, actually. So we hopefully have a bit more detail on that coming out in the next couple of weeks or so. And this framing is very different to the sort of euphoric thing you see here, where you see some of the world's highest emitters chinking their champagne glasses before they fly home in their private jets. So why is it we can actually have this sort of euphoria when actually when you play out the challenges we face, it looks nothing like euphoric? And it's significantly because of people I've mentioned before, that the integrated assessment modellers, the policymakers, have received and have wanted to receive, as have civil society, as have the academics, as has everyone else, we've all wanted to receive a more rosy, upbeat story about climate change. And if you get economists into a room and give them a big computer, they can give you an upbeat story about climate change. So we've got this set of modellers called the integrated assessment modellers. There are small groups of these around the world. There's only a handful of them. At these big modelling groups, and they have, they say, a simple climate model, by and large a standard economic growth model, so a near classical general equilibrium approach to them. Any of economists? Does Extinction Rebellion not allow economists in? <doesn't they? laughs> Anyone can join, but except for economists. No, that's unfair. I mean, ecological economists have a lot to offer this debate. Neoclassical economists, I think, have nothing, and maybe I'll come back to that later. But they use a standard sort of economic growth model in this, and then they have some sort of estimates of how rapidly can technology enter a system, enter society, and they sort of play all this together in these huge models so other people can't replicate it. They're very complicated, and they come out with these optimized answers about how you can deal with climate change. And these modelers have provided a much more appealing story than the pure science provides. So they have much bigger carbon budgets, much less challenging mitigation, much less, so not that curve, but instead, curves look more like that. So if you don't want the blue one, don't worry. We've got some nice people to give you a red one.
Oh, I feel much better.
Yeah. as a point, academics love the red one because that means you can carry on flying to some conferences and you can claim that you're doing something really worthwhile while you're buzzing around the world, having a dinner with your friends. So if you take the median value in the IPCC scenario, it's about 1,500 gigatons. So what you get here is yet the IPCC science broadly saying we can dump something like 650 billion tonnes of CO2 in the atmosphere, and you get the IPCC integrated assessment modellers say dominated by a particular economic group, but there are scientists and engineers in there as well, saying it's nearer 1,500. There's a huge difference between the two. And how on earth are you supposed to make any sense of that? And if you're a policymaker, which one would you prefer? If you're going on a holiday to Bali, which one would you prefer? You know, we all prefer the 1,500 one. And what's actually gone on is, has anyone seen this wonderful climate change film? Dr. Strangelove. If you haven't seen it, there's two climate change films I recommend. Dr. Strangelove, which is not about climate change, but tells you a lot about technology and certain types of men. Naomi Resky's and Eric Conway's Merchants of Doubt. That's fantastic. That is a climate change film. That's a more modern one. They're both really good. But they give you a real flavour, I think, of why we're not responding to climate change. Collectively, I think, tell you a lot about why we're not responding. There are other things as why we're not responding as well, but these are important. So how do you make sense of these two numbers that look miles apart? And this sounds flippant, but we are actually pulling rabbits from hats. And just because academics are doing it on computer models and shoving a partial differential equation in front of it does not make it any less magical. It may look like maths, but it's just magic. What we're planning to do is to, we've conjured up, and that is the right expression, because initially that's what it was, really just conjuring it up out of thin air. We've conjured up this concept of negative emission technologies. Now, I will make clear that these things don't exist at scale. There's some pilot plants, very small ones now, but most of it's in the imagination of academics. I think we should research them. They could be a really important tool that we should be applying to suck CO2 out of the atmosphere in the future. But I think we shouldn't assume that they will work. And the level in the models is absolutely huge, I'll show you in a second. So we have these models. They're going to suck out of the atmosphere hundreds of billions of tons of CO2 across the rest of the century and into the century beyond, to allow us to have this curve rather than the blue curve. So if you play out the negative emissions, you see it coming out here, starting in sort of 2035-ish, going out to the end of the century, and going beyond the end of the century. So I'm hoping with a bit of stem cell research, there'll still be cycling and rock climbing around here and then sort of grumbling around in the last few years here. But most of you, some of you here will be out here, but even your children will have to be doing this. Some of the ones who weren't here when the first IPCC report came out, your children will have to be sucking our CO2 out of the atmosphere. That's what we're locking into almost every single model. So it's a deeply systemic bias that's there. And once you get a bias that's that deeply ingrained, it's just normal. It's just normalized. Of course you have negative emission technologies. The language starts to get talked about in a normal way, and it becomes something you've made real just by talking about it. And that's a very good question. I try and stay out of, I have my own political views on the world, and I try to remove those from what I'm talking about here. So I think you can't accept the growth model and deal with climate change laid out in the Paris Agreement. I don't think they're compatible. That doesn't mean to say you can't improve female literacy or quality of rivers or indeed material consumption in some poor parts of the world or indeed some parts of the UK. So you can have growth in certain things around the world, but collectively you can't have ongoing economic growth. So I would argue that. You can make arguments on a broader sustainability perspective. You can also make arguments on a factor within a round planet perspective, and that decoupling can't be 100%, but they're sort of other sets of arguments. But from this point of view, I think this is a flawed model. It's more than a flawed model, and I wasn't going to talk about that now, but are any of you engineers? Are they not allowed in either? Just people whose professions begin in E aren't allowed in. that's not making much sense now. But in engineering, and there's lots of other things like this as well, but in engineering, if you're looking at a car, I know you shouldn't be driving cars, it's an electric car driven by something, renewable power. You look at this car going through the air quite slowly, then the air flows neatly over it. It's called laminar flow. If the car goes really fast, what you get is lots of turbulence, lots of mess in the air going all over the place. Now, laminar flow tells you nothing about turbulence. So above a certain speed, what you're getting in terms of the effects on the air, you know nothing about that if you look at it from laminar flow. They're completely different ways of looking at the world. And it's the same in economics. The neoclassical growth model sort of works if you're talking about small changes with everything else pretty much near what we call equilibrium. Everything else is sort of where it was before. Small changes with an infinite number of consumers, an infinite number of suppliers, an infinite perfect knowledge for everyone. All of that then works, sort of, to say that's good for society, for some point anyway, to some period in the future. But we're not looking at that here. We're looking at huge changes, miles away from equilibrium, with not necessarily everyone involved, everyone's impacted, but only actually a relatively small number of people have got to make the changes. So there is nothing really about the world that we're looking at that fits with the model. So it would be like using laminar flow on a car to understand turbulent flow. No one would do it. You would never use Newton mechanics to understand Einstein. They're just different things, not for economists. They've got their model and they use it regardless of the scale of the challenge that you're looking at, if that makes sense. I wasn't going to talk about that tonight, but anyway, so I think, although we use the model because it fits neatly with the current way that we like to think of the economy and society, it's completely the wrong tool for the job, which is actually an article I wrote recently in Science, I think, calling it that, the wrong tool for the job. But it does give us nice political answers. So negative emissions, hugely important in the models. So let's imagine we take these negative emissions away and we don't use them. As I say, we think we should research them, but we shouldn't assume they work. And now let's look, what does that mean for the UK? Let's try and bring it down to the UK. And here, because I'm from Manchester, I'm going to talk about pies. Though I have to be careful what I say, because in Manchester we call them tarts, a Manchester tart it's called, so be careful the language we use. And in Sweden it's a bula. But so we have a set carbon pie of carbon dioxide that we can emit from now out across to forever. And it could be a bit bigger if we're really lucky on the science. That's not looking very likely, as it turns out. It looks like it's going to be a bit smaller, and possibly quite a lot smaller. But at the moment, the sort of the best of our conservative science tells us we've got about 650 billion tonnes we can spew into the atmosphere from the globe, from energy. And you've got to split that amongst every country in the world, and you'll immediately think that's going to be a bit difficult, because everyone's going to want, like Britain, want a large slice, and we've only got one pie. So how do you do that? And that's been a real problem, actually, trying to get countries to think fairly about this issue. There are certain things you can do if you look in some sort of things in philosophy about how you might try and do this. And one thing is you get people to negotiate for another country. So don't negotiate for your own country. So get the UK to negotiate for Ghana. Get Nigeria to negotiate for the US. Get the US to negotiate for Taiwan, the Taiwanese for someone else. You know. So everyone negotiates for another part of the world. And if you play that out, you know, that sort of game theory and sort of think about poker, everyone plays a fairer hand. So there are ways to think about it, but we don't want to do that. We just send our negotiators, and before they get there, we just say, get as much as you can. And everyone says that. And then, of course, we fail. So we have to solve this problem. And if we don't solve this problem, then we fail on climate change. So as academics, what we've done with some colleagues in the Tyndall Centre and in colleagues in Uppsala as well, we've tried to look at the global pie and said, you know, how much should the rich countries get? So what we've first done, I won't go into the details, but we firstly said, you know, how much of the pie should the poor parts of the world have if they're going to carry on with some level of development? So we've asked that question first. And then we say, well, what's left for the wealthy part of the world? And that's quite an iterative process because there's not much pie left. But it means at least we are thinking first about the poor parts of the world rather than the usual thing, which is how much do we want and the poor people can have the crumbs that are left. So we've tried to turn that round, and that's in our paper that's coming out soon. Now, this is not to scale. This is just a pie with a slice out of it. This pie could be a bit bigger, this slice could be a bit bigger or a bit smaller, because how do you divide the pie up? Do you divide it on population? Do you divide it on the current population or the future population? Do you divide it on your historical emissions for the last 100 years, the historical emissions for the last 30 years, recent emissions, your capacity to respond to climate change, how much renewable energy potential you've got, what size is your economy? There are lots of ways you can divide the cake up. And so we've looked at this and divided the cake up using some of these ways you can think about that we think are the more appropriate ones. And so we have a slice, we have a range of slices sizes for the OECD, a bit smaller and a bit bigger than that. And then we say, how much does actually the UK get? And then you can split that again in different ways. So these are just showing little slices, but they could be a bit bigger or smaller. And then what the numbers play out, I haven't updated that. That should say, because our paper's out now, 2.8 to 3.7, but it doesn't really matter. The numbers are very near. So that's how much we can dump in the atmosphere for the UK. That includes aviation and shipping, but it doesn't include our imports and exports. So it's the things that we directly control. Now that again probably means very little.
We directly control our imports. We just stop buying stuff.
You can, but you have to also think about that as well. Because I mean, so my laptop. Consumption-based emissions are important, but do I know if my laptop was made in a particular part of China where they might have used renewable energy for smelting, or do I know if it's made in an area where they use coal? So it's really hard to know about imports and exports. And also, you've got to think, I mean, I'm completely opposed to us importing flying in roses from Kenya. But if you stopped it overnight, people would be starving in Kenya probably the following. So we have to think about that process and we have to change it very rapidly. But yes, they are something we have some control over, but the levers aren't quite so direct.
We should just ignore it.
No, I'm not saying we should ignore it. And I have a lot of discussion with that in Sweden. But if we don't even control our territorial emissions at the moment that we can control. But yeah, we should be thinking about imports and exports. They're really important, and I think both of those should be used, because one of them we've got much better control over. We know accurately what the emissions are that we emit from within our boundaries, because basically if we burn fossil fuels, we know exactly how much CO2 comes out. We don't know that with imports and exports. There's a big variation in the data, by as much as 20 or 30% in estimates from different groups doing the work. So it's much harder to work it out accurately. But I think it's important to bear that in mind. So this includes aviation shipping, but doesn't include imports and exports. And that's 9 years of current emissions. So when I said before, it's 8 years. 9 years of current emissions in the UK would have blown its fair chance of or contribution to the 2 degree C framing. So you know, it's not much time. It's not like 2050. So let's convert those budgets now into mitigation rates. And I should say, well, I very sadly just died a few months ago. It was my uncle, my best friend actually, just lived up here. This is the west coast of Scotland, the Isle of Arran. So he was a shepherd up there. Not very good for carbon emissions, but he only had 300 sheep because it's really bad quality land. But that's where I'm going to go when climate change hits. So headline mitigation for the UK is, if you play out those budgets, if we reduce emissions from the 1st of January 2020 at something like 10 to 13% every single year, there or thereabouts, starting now, that means something like a 30% reduction in our emissions by 2022, 30% in the next 3 years, and something like 70% by the end of the century, by the end of the decade rather, compared with now, not compared to 1990, compared with now, and fully decarbonised energy by 2035 to 2040, and probably for us, probably nearer the 2035 for the wealthy parts, for the wealthier of the wealthy parts of the world. So that's planes, trains, ships, industry, cars, houses, heating, everything. Zero carbon energy, not low, zero, or virtually zero, we define for that. So know that that is different to the sort of framing that Extinction Rebellion is using. This is real zero emissions from energy by that time for a reasonable probability of 2 degrees centigrade, if we're lucky on climate sensitivity. If you wanted 1.5 degrees, it would be a long time before that. You have to be, you know, the sorts of dates that you're talking about in Extinction Rebellion is probably broadly in line with the carbon budgets for a good chance of 1.5 degrees centigrade. I don't know how you'd achieve it, but I think probably what you're calling for is broadly in line with what the science says is necessary for 1.5, if that's possible at all, given that we're probably at 1.1-ish now. So this requires immediate and profound changes to the system that we live in today. This is not about tweaking business as usual, or it's not about the language of nudge that someone used today. That's not what we're talking about. So are there any examples of sort of this level of profound system change? I was quite depressed when I came back from the bond negotiations a few years ago. It had been one of the most divisive things I've ever been to. Firstly, there was a separation between civil society and the sort of elite policymaking groups. So civil society had their bit over there and the policymakers over here, and there was hardly any flow between them. The journalists were pretty much over in the policy side, not over at the civil society groups. They claimed it was a zero carbon event. It was basically tents that were heated next door to an expanding brown coal mine in Germany. And it was zero carbon emissions because it was offset. So we were burning brown coal to heat up a tent for a couple of weeks for us to chat about climate change. It's just so depressing. That's the best we can do. And I got some photographs as well in the evening, which I put on Twitter, which went quite a lot of people retweeted them, of all the screens on in the evening. All the huge screens and TV screens, which everyone had gone home. I was one of the last few there sort of doing some work. And everything was still on. But it was all right because it was offset. It was a carbon neutral event. So on the way back on the train back up to Sweden, I started to think about this because it was very depressing. I thought I might as well just pack up. And I was thinking about whether the politicians or scientists or academics, businesses, journalists, or even civil society, pretty much when we look what we're all up talking about and what we're up to, and I think Extinction Rebellion are a bit of an exception to this, but so this is more sort of the collective outcome. It's hell in a handcart. We're failing at every single level that we can imagine. So there were almost no sign of hope out there, and that was not a good position to be in on a train heading north. So I was asking myself, by the time I got through to north of Germany, heading towards Denmark, is there any light in despair? Can you see some hope out there? Otherwise, what's the point of trying? Anyway, Leonard Cohen comes back in to save the day. So there's a crack in everything. So this sort of depression and disillusionment with the system as it is in terms of climate change. Since 2008, in the last 10 years or so, what have we seen that's sort of almost like system-level change? And I think there's a number of them. Firstly, I'm not saying these are good or bad, so that's important to bear in mind. The banking crisis. Go back to 2006, 2005. Could you have imagined the banking crisis like we saw? Don't think anyone really would envisage a banking crisis like that happening overnight. Could you imagine in 2006 that the Chancellor of the Exchequer in the UK would suddenly find £500 trillion to spend on bailing out the banks in one way or another? Now, we haven't got any money for anything. We haven't got any money for this, that, the other. We have for bailing out the banks. We can mobilise resources instantly. Now, some of it's just digital sort of pretend money, but some of that is real shift of resources. And those resources primarily were, of course, from the public purse given to the private purse, which is not really an appropriate thing to do. But anyway, what I'm saying is that if we want to respond to climate change, we haven't got any money as an excuse. We're wealthy parts of the world, and even poor parts of the world, we're carrying out quantitative easing. We can mobilise resources in different directions if we so choose to do so. social media. And people of my generation, you know, we weren't brought up with it. We had no idea what social media was. It's a new term. I'm still not quite sure what it is. It will keep, every time I sort of feel I've got a hand of it, it seems to sort of morph off in a different direction. You know, I'm okay with Twitter. That's what I deal with. That's my bit. But yeah, that's changed the whole power structure of the media barons. So it has repercussions, many of them, I think, which are really problematic. There are some massive problems with social media. But overall, I think it's a significant benefit. So I've had a lot of argument with journalists about this. If I had the choice between four rich white men owning the newspapers for the last 100 years, so we always get the same news for 100 years, so it's completely, you know, we're embedded with it from our childhood, or 60 million nutters tweeting, which one would you have? I'll have 60 million nutters tweeting, thanks, every time. Now, it's our job as the users of media to be discerning users of media. So you have to think about what we're reading and who's saying it and why they're saying it and check it out against other things. But at least now all sorts of people can have their voices. So if a janitor's got a great idea, that can be just as important as a professor, probably more so. So it's the idea that matter. And we can all voice these things through social media in a way we couldn't do that before. So I think there's some real benefits of social media, and there are massive negatives to it, as we're all probably fully aware in lots of respects. But who would have guessed it was there? Who would have guessed that we'd have had Brexit? I'm making no comment whether it's a good or a bad thing. Make your own judgment on that. But you know, certainly I don't think we would have imagined that happening if we went back 10 years. If we went back 6 years, you probably couldn't imagine it happening. Who would imagine that we'd have the US run by an orange gentleman? I mean, whatever you might think about it in one way or another. I mean, these are sort of things you could not really imagine and yet have occurred completely out of the blue. The Arab Spring, I mean, turned out to be a disaster for many people, a lot of people killed, but nevertheless, I think no one imagined, or very few people imagined, that sort of thing happening so quickly, partly fueled, of course, by social media. And there's some sort of second sense of that occurring in some parts of that part of the world now. So it's interesting these things are occurring. The plummeting price of renewables. Even people in the renewables industry didn't think renewables prices would go as low as they are now, and that they haven't bottomed out. They're still going down. I mean, they are destabilizing the energy market to some extent, because no one knows, well, what do I invest in? Because the renewables are getting cheaper and cheaper. And even the IMF, that well-known left-wing think tank. The International Monetary Fund, it's not a left-wing thing. But the IMF, it's the sort of voice of sort of orthodox establishment views, really. They're pointing out in 2015 that the subsidy to fossil fuels was $5.3 trillion that year. That's the IMF were pointing that out. That's more than any subsidy to fossil fuels, to renewables. Now it's because of the environmental implications, the direct subsidy, and some on climate change. But also talking about the actual health implications of burning fossil fuels. So they're talking about those things really seriously. So there's a whole suite of things happening here. In isolation, none of them are changing the whole system. But I think when I was looking at this, well, there are some big cracks in there. And so through those big cracks, are we seeing any light? So that's, Cohen's lyric here, that's how the light gets in. I should say that I know Greta Thunberg quite well. I'm engaged with her quite a lot. I was looking, I talked with her and her family about the things she's doing and the work she's doing, and primarily about what the sort of scientific component of what she's talking about is, and she will then read what I and other people who provided the information are suggesting, and she will make her judgment on it. So she makes her own judgments on these things, but who would have thought that a 15-year-old schoolgirl, now 17 now, I think just, could actually mobilise or catalyse this new debate. Now, she's not going to solve climate change, she's not a saviour, but her voice has been incredibly powerful because of its clarity and because of a number of other reasons, I think, to do with her condition that allow her to see through things that many of us can't. So it's a sort of, in a sense, like she said this before, she has this sort of superpower, which allows her to see things in a clearer way, without the sort of delusion that many of us sort of have without thinking about it. So I think she's been really important in this. That's a shard of light. But she has also catalyzed amongst a whole swathe of people around the world, this sort of youth movement, which is really important. It started to significantly change the debate. But then you've got things like Extinction Rebellion. Who could have imagined just 2.5 years ago something like this would sort of just come out of the earth? It is another shard of light. And whatever people may think one way or another about these things, they are fundamentally changing the debate. And flying shame, or if you look at the Swedish, it's probably more like flying conscience than shame. But what's interesting is that people like me and the heads of NGOs more generally and other academics have been trying to get people engaged on climate change for 30 years and fundamentally failed. And in 2 years, a few kids and an oddball group of people called Extinction Rebellion have managed to mobilize forces and create a debate that we have just not managed to do at all. It's changed the whole tenor of all of these things. And that, to me, there are some really important shards of light here. This isn't going to solve climate change, but at least we're starting to discuss it in a more reasoned fashion than we were before. So I think there are some real shards of light out there. So I want to sort of pull this towards the end now, but what does this play out like in terms of real action if we deliver on climate change? And I'm going to go back to this concept of equity, how absolutely key this is. And I'm always told that, Stephen Hawking was told this by his editor, that if you use an equation, you lose half your readership. So I'm hoping that you can cope with one equation here. Paris plus IPCC, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, equals equity. Now, I'm not making that equation because I think it's the appropriate sort of political view that I hold, or that's the appropriate moral argument. I'm simply saying that's what the maths tell us. So we can take our, regardless of our political persuasion, regardless of our moral position, we can just look at the maths. And I think often we should look at the maths, because the world can't be solved with numbers, but they can sometimes give us a flavour of what's important. So CO2 is highly skewed towards a few people, as you're probably all aware of this stuff. This is taken out of the Oxfam report in 2015, but it was based on the really good work done by Lucas Chancel and Thomas Piketty, and they were looking at where the emissions come from. So these are the income deciles at a global level, but you can look at this in countries as well, to some countries anyway, and their level of emissions. And actually the UK, we're trying to look at this in a bit more detail, but the UK looks not too dissimilar to the inequalities you see at sort of global level. As when I work in Sweden, it's more egalitarian society, it's not as unequal, but even there we're seeing big differences in our estimates of who emits what. So if you play this out, and we think it's probably not too far off for the UK, 50% of the emissions come from just 10% of the population, 70% of the emissions from just 20% of the population. And I often say, again, this is probably an unusual audience, that Pareto's rule, Pareto's rule of thumb, the 80-20 rule. So you probably can think about that here. Probably 80% of the emissions of people in this room come from just 20% of you. So if you look at the person next to you, they might be the high emitter. Now, you're probably all quite low emitters, I don't know. But it is actually interesting when you do that, people are looking around and think, well, and you normally know, if you looked at their salaries, you normally know who the high emitters are, because it does correlate very closely with income. So does this matter? You often hear the sort of language, actually inequality is not that important, because actually overall everyone's doing much better. But actually play out the maths. The maths, again, are important. So a thought experiment. Imagine, and again, this is not an audience I would normally have to ask this one to, but imagine that climate change was a serious issue, an existential threat. Imagine we actually believe that at a societal level. And then imagine we put in regulations, because it's not going to be done voluntarily, to get the top 10% of global emitters, remember this is global emitters, but I think this would broadly hold for the UK or something very similar, to cut their carbon footprint to the level of the average European citizen, EU citizen, not even European, EU citizen. The EU is a strange collective group over to the other side of the channel that we used to be probably still a part of for a few more weeks, anyway, a couple of more weeks. So imagine the top 10%, cut to the level of the EU, not the level of the average Ghanaian, but the average EU person, and the other 90% make no changes. And what that maths tells you is that's a one-third cut in global CO2. So it just shows that the emissions are massively skewed to the lifestyles of a relatively few people. And in a lot of audiences, they always say, and you know who they are, because when you put your makeup on in the morning or have a shave, and I'm not saying that, any gender can be doing both of those things, we see them in the mirror. And that's probably different with an Extinction Rebellion audience, at least it may well be, I don't know. But certainly if it's an academic audience, we're the high emitters. So we know who this group particularly are. But the idea that we can do this one-third cut, if we thought climate change was a really serious issue, we could do this in a year. And I made the point this afternoon that I think if you really thought your child's life depended on it, we could do it in a week. But we're not doing it at all. And remember, the reductions for Paris are no cut by 2030. And yet that would be achievable in very little time. So the emissions are hugely skewed to a small group, a relatively small group of the population. Maybe in the UK, 20-30% of the population are responsible for the lion's share, way above the lion's share of the emissions. And this all gives us, I think, one strategy, but with three elements to it, about what we have to do to deliver on Paris. And I think this holds for almost any country, but it doesn't tell you what the policies look like. The policies will vary depending on the culture of the society you're looking at. So the first thing is, we have to get off the curve really quickly. because we're high up in the emissions, so you've got to come off that curve really rapidly. You can't do that with technology, because you can't put it in place fast enough. You can't electrify all the housing in the world, in the UK in that time frame. So if we're looking at the UK here. So you've got to change the behaviours and practices of the high energy users. So you have to have policies in place that drive that, because they're not going to do it voluntarily. And if you don't do that, then you fail, because you've got to come off the curve in the first few years because the emissions are so high. But then you also need to make sure that everything we buy is very, very efficient. So you can't buy an A-rated refrigerator. An A-rated refrigerator consumes between 60 and 80% more energy than an A++++ refrigerator. So why are we selling them? A is crap. That's what it should sound like. And you shouldn't be, anyway, it shouldn't be a label on it. It should just be a standard set for the company that makes the refrigerators. You shouldn't be have the choice between an A and an A++++. If you can do A++++ refrigerators, they should all be like that if you buy a new one. Same for cars, you know, same for industrial appliances or laptops. You set an efficiency standard, as I often say, that what will happen is you always hear the financial directors squeal. And we've heard that for years. The car industry squealed like mad when the EU said it was going to put some legislation in. We can never get you down to 130 grams per kilometre. Now they've got whole loads of cars that do less than that. So don't listen to the financial directors. The engineers will deliver if you give them a spec, by and large. Yeah, yeah. Air quality is a. Yeah. No. That's true. I mean, actually, using the health, getting people to engage on climate change through health is actually probably much more successful than getting them to engage on climate change through climate change issues. Mm-hmm. They're much more engaged in issues of health. There are air quality, but also then in terms of heating of houses, how many children have bronchial conditions because they're in fuel poverty houses. Yeah, 10 to 20% of houses in the UK are fuel poverty. And so we have a whole lot of health issues that come out of our system as we have. Yeah, we should be addressing those, and they are important. But there are some problems with some of those things as well. They don't always work synergistically. Sometimes they do counter each other as well. But most of the time, it is, yeah. But not just from that point of view. It's also a big health issue for some of the poor parts of the world because the temperature's gone up so high. It means that they can't have development as fast as they would have to help themselves move into better quality lives, which development is important for them immediate to near term, because the temperatures are so high that you can't do a lot of the physical work that you would otherwise do. So for some parts of the world, just the temperature becomes a problem.
Or you migrate, which is a health issue.
It could be a military issue, and all sorts of issues come out of migration, yeah. So efficiency standards. And the other thing is, of course, we need to completely fundamentally shift, like the Marshall-style plan after the Second World War, when you reconstructed Europe after we'd blown it all up. We've got it's that level of change we're talking about with our energy system. We've got to make it basically all zero carbon in really 20 years. And at the moment, only quite a small part of it is electricity. So we probably have to have a massive program of electrification, of heating, of transport, of a lot of industry and so forth. So all of the other three phases. It doesn't tell you what the policies would be. But what is important here, and this again is not a socialist argument. It could be, but it's not. This is a maths argument. The labor and the resources that currently furnish the relative luxuries of the high emitters up here are going to be required to make this transformation. And the big problem with most people working on climate change is they see it as a bolt-on to the existing system. It would have been a bolt-on to the existing system if we started in 1990 or 2000. But in 2020, you've got to change the existing system because we've left it too late. So that labour and resources are going to be required to do this. And that's going to be going on for the next 20 years. And there's no neat way out of that. And that's why we use negative emissions, because we don't like that story. And just to give a flavour of that, you start to think what we're saying to people. No more large houses, no more holiday homes, no more second homes. Imagine some of the large houses where I live out, well, not so much where I live, but if you go out to the other side of Manchester, out to Wilmslow and that, outside the sort of Cheshire Belt of Manchester. The house there, you have to split them up so there were three houses rather than one mansion. Can you imagine the people in there being happy with that? They're the sorts of things we're talking about. No more holiday homes, no second homes, no prestige cars, SUVs, multiple car ownership. You mean changing the whole transport structure there. No highly mobile lives, no frequent flyers, business of first-class travel, no high levels of consumer goods. Again, you're always simply saying, we can go back to these levels of inequality once we solve climate change if we want to. There'd be some other sustainability implications of it there. But in the meantime, we need that labour to do this and resources in 20 years. We need new narratives, desperately need new narratives. What constitutes growth, progress and development? What are the things that really matter to us? And we need to rethink reframe value and how we reward success. We reward success by giving people more money, access to more resources, therefore a higher carbon footprint. We've got to rethink that framing of what success means, if indeed we should be rewarding success at all, which I think is, I'm not certain about, but anyway. We need to think about time in a much more sort of relative fashion in many respects, but also think about the near term, the long term, and the very long term in ways that we haven't considered it before. We just tend to have a very sort of short-term lens on these things. We need to embed intra and intergenerational equity. Think about poor people elsewhere suffering from climate change today, but also about our own children suffering about it tomorrow. And we think we need a much, much more deeper appreciation of the non-human world. That's, I struggled for quite a while to get the right word for that. That may not be the right word anyway, but it's sort of the more than human world, because it's, we are part of that world. It's not a separate thing. And that, one of our problems, I think, is we've separated ourselves. We've tried to separate ourselves from nature, and that, you know, that fundamentally has failed. So, so I think there's sort of, we need new storylines there that help us understand the world differently. So to conclude, climate change is now system change. We've left it so late that we have to change the system. That isn't, you know, that's not a choice that I'm here making for any political reasons. It's simply what the math tells us. So if we want to deliver on the Paris Agreement, we have no choice that I can understand. And as Einstein, or it's attributed to him anyway, is that insanity is doing the same thing over and over again and expecting a different result. And I would say thus far, we've chosen to pass onto our own children the consequences of 30 years of insanity. You know, we have had the same delusional clap chat for 30 years, and we are handing on to our children a really appalling future. Perhaps in 2020, that should say, things are changing, and go back to Leonard Cohen's quote, ring the bells that still can ring, forget your perfect offering. There's a crack in everything, and that's how the light gets in. And I'm going to finish off with a slide which I didn't use earlier today. It's saying, what can we do? And this is probably not the right audience for this, because Extinction Rebellion are doing things anyway. But people often say, well, what can we do? And one thing I think it's important, I'll explain why this is, because maybe not everyone will agree. We have to make changes ourselves, and particularly those of us that are high emitters. So make changes in our lifestyle. Try and identify what our high carbon activities are, or our unsustainable activities, and try and change them. And that's really important, not because of the emissions. The emissions, by and large, don't matter from any one person. But what they do is they allow us to talk about that with our friends and our family. So we create a debate. We start to think about the changes that we need to bring about and how hard they might be or how easy they were. Well, you know, all sorts of things. Be honest about them. But if we don't do them ourselves, then we lose credibility in talking about them. And there's a whole swathe of social science research and psychology research that shows that. Credibility is improved if people see that you broadly abide by your own arguments. Try and do the things and then talk about them. Just doing them is a bit pointless. Engage with our place of work. That might be a school, it could be a university, it could be a company, it could be a sports club, but, you know, whatever it might be, the place that you spend some time messing around, or you go down the pub every night, talk to people there. Start to talk to these people and you know, about what they might be able to do. Make arguments and suggest changes that they could think about. But also, I think it's important to engage with our MPs, with our councillors, and for this audience, again, you're probably already doing this to some extent, but we don't really, we've sold out. You know, I think civil society is almost like sold out on its own democracy. Okay, the end voting bit is crap, first past the post, it's just garbage. But the actual process of democracy in the UK is still incredibly vibrant and strong. We can still get to see our MPs during the surgery. We can still vote them in and out every so often, and they know damn well that the large majorities no longer hold. So they will vote on issues that they think their constituents think is important to some extent. So we need to engage more with our MPs. And we should directly criticise them. We can use social media for that. We can use the press. We can write letters. Most of us are reasonably eloquent and erudite. We can write these sort of things. So,
and that usually works.
Second?
Shout.
Yeah, well, any courteous stuff. Firm but courteous. But so if their actions don't meet their commitments, let them know in no uncertain terms and get other people to write to them and let them know. And that's quite easy to do nowadays. It doesn't even take a lot of time. But also use the press for doing that. But the other thing is that if they're doing things that are right, that are good, also tell them that, because they never get support. Britain's a great place for moaning, but we virtually never tell people when they've done something well. I think we should remember that in our lives. You know, when people do something well near us, tell them, because it's, you know, they don't know they're doing something well. Generally, we don't know that, and we're so reluctant to say it here for some bizarre reason. So support MPs and councillors when they do something you agree with, and, you know, counter them when you don't. So I think there's plenty of things that we can do to help drive the process. It's a, ultimately, responding to climate change is a partnership between bottom-up and top-down. It's not going to be delivered by the great and good. It won't be delivered just by grassroots movements. It's some messy, interrelated partnership between those things. If we're going to succeed, it will emerge out of that in a way that we can't really see. But you know, we have to play our role in bottom-up in this. So thank you very much for listening. We know what we need to do. This is not to scale. This is just a pie with a slice out of it.